Some locations are so massive you can't see the wood for the trees. Esterhorn, the unknown twin location of Vesterhorn, is just such a location and one of my absolute favorite locations to photograph in Iceland.
I think it's worth it. Incredible light. I'm literally on top of the world. So Esterhorn has fast become one of my absolute favorite locations in all of Iceland, and it's easy to see why. Esterhorn is actually related to Vesterhorn, Stuxnes, as you can see right over there. And it kind of has the same features. You have two mountain peaks and you have like a seascape location around it. It's just an absolutely stunning and epic and huge location, and of course it speaks a lot to me.
Esterhorn is one of those locations that has gone underneath the radar of popular tourism and even landscape photography tourism. That is probably due to its location even further east than Stuxnes. Most people simply don't reach that far east. Unless you know it is there, you will probably just pass it as you are driving so close to the mountains, which are the main focal point, you won't notice their characteristic shape. I talk from experience here. Located only a 40 minutes drive from Stuxnes, it's very easy to find as you are literally driving straight through the scene. Just aim for and park at Kvalnes Lighthouse. Relative to the perspective from the main road, the perspective from the lighthouse has changed the scene dramatically and presents one of the most impressive photography locations in Iceland. Having parked at the lighthouse, you simply just follow the paths down the hill to find a foreground using the mountains as the main focal point. I've been to Esterhorn on several occasions with Iceland photo tours, but it was the day where I visited the location with my fellow YouTuber Nigel Danson. We had the entire day to really immerse ourselves in the location and spend a lot of time there. Actually around 14 hours. The only thing to stop you from taking photos here are low-hanging clouds, which covers the mountains, and that does happen from time to time.
So I come down here by the side of the sea, and right now I'm just waiting for the cliffs to be visible. They are probably going to break up in not too long of time. The main problem right now is that the sun has come out, and with the sun on the foreground, it's kind of hard to make a long exposure, and it doesn't really look that good either. So there is a brim of clouds that might cover it, so I'm hoping for that to happen. Until then, I have just like attached my 16-35mm because I want to have the entire scene within the frame. I have my 6-stop filter on because I usually, as you already know, only slow down water to something between 0.5 seconds and 2 seconds. So a little bit about the composition. We have the waves coming in here, which creates a very, very strong foreground with lots of visual flow leading up into the beach and up into the mountains. So right now it is low tide and it has just changed, so the tide is on its way in. That is of course always something you need to be aware of when you make seascape photography. Also, the waves have started increasing in size, which it's not dangerous at all right now, but you might get wet feet, so of course also be aware of that. Also at this particular location, the rocks can be very, very slippery, so you might even want to bring some crampons, even though there's no snow or ice.
I'd go as far as to say Esterhorn is a landscape photography playground and beginner's paradise. As at Stuxnes, you have several options for strong foregrounds, which varies quite a lot during the seasons. You have both trails, rocks, different colored grass, a small pool, cliffs along the shore, a black sand beach and waves for seascapes as you've already seen, and much more to play around with. The small pool is perfect for reflection photos if the wind doesn't ruin it, and during winter it's probably frozen, delivering beautiful frozen patterns and bubbles underneath the ice. At the small pool, which is relatively close to the parking lot at the lighthouse, you will also realize that Esterhorn is an ultra-wide angle location. Unless you want to stitch together multiple photos, a 16mm lens or broader should be your go-to lens. This doesn't mean you can't squeeze in the mountains with a 24mm lens, but in that case you are locked to horizontals. For this location as at Stuxnes, I would recommend an 11-24mm. Esterhorn is quite a windy location, and when Nigel and I visited, we only had a window of about an hour to fly our drones before the forecast predicted the wind to increase, which it certainly did. For Esterhorn, I mainly focused on videography with my drone, and flying all the way up close to the mountains gives a both fascinating and impressive view. You can of course also fly the drone out over the sea, but anyone owning a drone knows that comes with a certain amount of nervousness. The drone technology has become better the past years, but that doesn't hold back a gust from pushing your drone off course, so be aware of the wind strength and direction of the wind before taking off. Since I visited this location on several occasions during the winter, I've had plenty of time to scout around, and I find one of the strongest foregrounds to be the cliffs along the shore.
So it is incredibly slippery down here, but I think it's worth it. Incredible light. So make sure to put my bag up here, as to not get it wet when the waves hit. Now I know this composition fairly well, I've been here before. The thing is, it has just never been as high tide as it is right now. And I am having waves coming in from behind, which makes it a bit more exciting than I like. So I gotta do this fast. So it's not that it's dangerous, it's more that I don't want to get wet, because I have more to do today. So for this scene, the settings are 16mm, ISO 100, around half a second of shutter speed, f11 and a 6-stop filter. And I have it on continuous shooting, so when a wave comes in, crashes in, I will simply just keep shooting on the way in and on the way out. I am not entirely sure what makes the most sense right now, so I'm just trying a few different shutter speeds. And in regard to the composition, of course we have all the water here in the foreground and the cliffs in the background.
A few minutes after I recorded this, the waves did become a bit too aggressive and I retreated to higher grounds where Nigel joined me.
So of course when you do seascape photography, you really need to be aware of your surroundings. When the tide is coming in and it's coming up, like, you start getting splashes and so forth. And one thing is that you get wet yourself, but of course if you are using some cameras which can't handle it, you need to be aware of that too. So usually when I do seascape photography, I always recommend people to photograph the waves as they pull out to get those beautiful streaks. But in a few cases, it actually makes a whole lot sense to photograph the waves as they come in and splash up towards the cliffs. When they splash up towards the cliff, you want to catch that explosion when it happens. And if you have a too long of a shutter speed, it just becomes one big blur. So I usually shoot with 0.3 or a quarter of a second when I do these kind of seascapes where the waves come crashing in. Look at this one, like right in the middle.
Oh wow, that's amazing.
Yeah. And this is the fantastic part about Esterhorn. It works really, really well as a both sunrise location and sunset location in winter half of the year. Right now we are actually straight on equinox. So the sun rises in the east and sets in the west. And as you can see, we have light on one cliff, but the other one is making a shadow for itself. So if it was just like a week ago or a couple of weeks ago, the left part of the rock would actually also be lit.
During winter, the sun rises straight on the right mountaintop, casting a shadow on the middle part of the mountain. The further away you get from midwinter, this shadow only grows. However, if you can hit the days around midwinter, the shadow does retract rather fast after sunrise, and the sun doesn't rise too far above the horizon, making the golden hour last the entire day. During summer, the sun sets and rises behind the mountains, making it possible to catch some flaming pre- or afterburns above the mountains.
So right now I'm making two kinds of shots. On one hand, I can fit it just within the 16mm. But if I really want to get like the entire location, including the clouds above, I am taking first one shot for the foreground and then one for the background. Then I will stitch them together in Photoshop and probably make a crop, which is a 1x1 or something like that. So Nigel, how do we find this?
Oh, it's just so amazing. I was just doing a piece of camera over there and it was, I couldn't explain just how stunning it is. It feels like how the earth was when it was first made. I just can't believe, you know, the volcanic sort of sand, sort of pebbles over there are just beautiful, but here we've just got everything, you know, the dark clouds, the beautiful light, the amazing rocks, and as you can see, we've got just a beautiful place to photograph it from. So yeah, it's just amazing.
As a less known location, Esterhorn delivers on all aspects of what I find fascinating about landscape photography. I'd even go as far as to say it's all the way up there with Westerhorn, Kirkefell and the Ice Beach. And contrary to these locations, Esterhorn is not overrun with neither tourists nor photographers. As already stated, Eysturoyartunnilin is an absolutely epic location and one of my favorites in Iceland. Because of the angle from where you photograph the mountains, Eysturoyartunnilin is also a fantastic location for Northern Lights. Since the aurora forecast the day where Nigel and I visited Eysturoyartunnilin was very promising, we decided to stay here after sunset for some aurora photography. The next video is therefore the highly demanded video on photographing the Northern Lights. And of course, also remember to check out Nigel's video from this day.
Hopefully you can hear the roar of the ocean to the right of me as it just pounds the shoreline.